So guys, just to remind everybody, we're all innocent here. We're all innocent in each other's eyes. We don't come to judge what each other says, okay? We don't come to scrutinize it and whether it be right or wrong. What we're going to do here is we're just going to sit and share what God has revealed to us. And we can each reveal something as it comes to us, and it can build, okay? And so one person might say something that God's shown them, and then another person may be able to build on that, okay? And so what'll happen is God is with us. He's even in us. And so we'll come together and share our hearts and share what the Father has revealed to us. We'll share with each other. We'll build on each other. And then God will also build on the thing, okay? God will interpret the whole thing. But we just want to feel safe and innocent with each other and just feel free to share our hearts and recognize that, man, God is with us and God will edify all of us, okay? And so from that foundation, we'll just pray. Just thank you, Father, that, man, you hadn't left us here to sort the thing out ourselves. That you've come and you've revealed yourself to us. And you haven't just come and revealed yourself to us and then just gone home, but that you filled us with your Spirit. And so you're in us and you're even with us. And I just thank you, Lord, that, man, we can just feel innocent and safe and just share what's in our hearts. And we can just find our hearts hearing your voice and find you edifying all of us with the truth about who you are and what you think of us and what you've done. I just thank you, Father, that many, many lives can be healed and set free from this Q&A today, that great understanding can come to people concerning you, and that they'll no longer have a marred image in their heart of you, and that through that, they'll no longer have a marred image of themselves. Thank you, Father. Amen.
Amen.
Glory to God. I love the Q&As because it gets everybody talking, or at least gives people an opportunity to share with each other. And I know we've kind of been programmed into thinking that the best way is like a teacher classroom scenario. You know, and listen, it's not that that way's wrong or bad, but I think it's error if we conclude that's the best way, okay? That's like a corrupted good or evil, the knowledge of good and evil. And so I think many times we discount the revelation or the edification that can come from us just hanging out and talking about things together, you know, and seeing what we think about things, and then hearing the voice of God out of all of us, right? Because then we don't just get to know God, but we get to know each other, right? And I love what Jim says. We get to know the Christ in you, right? Christ is in Pat, and Christ is in Bethany, and Christ is in Michelle, and Christ is in Jamie. And man, we want to get to know the Christ in you. We want to get to know the authentic expression of the Father that you are. Because guess what? There's only one like you. There's only one, that's why you're an authentic expression of the Father. There's only one person that can reveal the Father the way you do. And so if you're not going to be you, no one else can. And if you're not going to be you, then that's an aspect of the Father that I can't see. And that's not to put you under some law. That's to help strengthen you with freedom. To just be okay with who you are and what you want to say. And God will sort the thing out. Glory to God. So, does anybody have anything lingering from last week or from the Q&A or just in their hearts that they want to share about the Q&A or not about the Q&A? And don't anybody feel any pressure to talk, because listen, I got lots of questions, and so if no one wants to talk, everybody here knows I can do many speakings.
Okay, I have a question.
Hi, Michelle.
Hi.
That's Michelle, guys. Hi, Michelle. That's my little sister. She needs a T-shirt that says, "I survived Greg." Seriously, there's a support group for all those guys.
I have a question. In us talking about the end times, you know how Adam was supposed to connect the heaven and the earth, and then Jesus came and did it instead. Why do you think that the heaven and earth weren't connected at that point in time? Like, why are we still here? Why did that not happen when Jesus died on the cross?
Yeah.
Are we here?
That's a great question. And so really what I did was I probably packed a year-long message into an hour and 10 minutes. And afterwards, I encourage you to go back and listen, because I tried to cram it in there, and I probably didn't explain it as well as I could. But what happens is once Jesus comes and finishes the work, there has to be a period of time for people to hear the gospel and believe. Okay, because if there's no period of time for people to hear the gospel and believe, then we can't be baptized in the Holy Spirit. right? We can't have the same spirit that conquered death in Jesus dwelling in us. And so if Jesus would have just come and done the work, and then heaven and earth would have physically joined, meaning the heaven and the sky and this earth, if they would have physically joined at that point, nobody would have had the Holy Spirit. And if none of us had the Holy Spirit, guess what? None of us would have had the Spirit in us that conquered death, that was in Jesus. And so there has to be a period of time before the physical earth and the physical heaven collide where people can hear what God's done to conquer death through the resurrection, and they can believe on Jesus, and then they can have the same hope of glory dwelling in them. And then that Spirit will clothe them in the same glory and fire that Jesus is clothed in. Okay? Because when Jesus comes back with the heaven and the earth, and heaven and earth collide, if we have not believed on the Spirit of God, it's not God or Jesus that's going to kill anybody. But if we're not clothed in the same glory that God is clothed in, when we see Him, we're going to find ourselves filled with fear instead of love. And we'll find that fear working condemnation in our hearts. And it's going to make us run away from God, and we're going to condemn ourselves to the second death. So there has to be a work to conquer death, and then there has to be a period of time. I called it the Jubilee period, I think, in the message, which is the gospel period, where God declares that death has been conquered, our debt to sin is paid, death is no longer reigning over us, and there's a period of time for people to come home. But if there hadn't been a period of time, no one could have been saved from death. Do you see what I'm saying? Does that make sense, or do you want me to keep elaborating? So Adam joined himself to death. There is a spirit in the world that brings death. Okay? When heaven and earth collide, death is going to be cast into the lake of fire, meaning death is going to be destroyed. Okay? Now, anybody who wanted to make themselves partakers in the second death, they're going to perish along with death. Okay? There's got to be a period of time where people can want eternal life, where they can hear that God's promised them eternal life, and they can say, yeah, man, I don't want to die. I want to live eternally with God loving on me. And then they believe. And then they can have the Spirit that raised Jesus up from death dwelling in them. Does that make sense?
Yeah, so we're technically in the Jubilee period right now.
We're technically in the Jubilee period where sin and death has been conquered. Jesus has declared it is finished. And the gospel message is like a trumpet echoing in the earth, telling all people, come home to your inheritance. Sin and death have been conquered, man. Come see your name in the book of life. Right? Come receive your inheritance, which is God's eternal life, and then ultimately a glorified creation. The righteous will inherit the earth. And they're not going to inherit an earth that's corrupted with sin and death. They're going to inherit an earth where there is no sin and death. And I think something that really blesses people is when Jesus conquered sin and death, everybody's name is written in the book of life. Everybody. The Bible doesn't say names are added to the book of life. It says they're blotted out of the book of life. Okay? So when Jesus conquered sin and death, everybody's name was added to the book of life. And now the trumpet is declaring to the world, come find your name in the book of life and take your inheritance, man. Come receive your inheritance, which is eternal life in a glorified creation where we co-reign together, where God and man reign together and they live on an earth with no sin and no death. Come see your name in the book of life. That's the period we're in now. And if you look in the Jewish types and shadows, that's what they did in the Jubilee, was everybody who was in debt were set free from their debts and they could go back to their inheritance. And they would find their name written under their tribe, and then that would tell them what their inheritance was. Well, guess what, man? We're the tribe of God. God's our tribe. Do you see what I'm saying? We're the God kind, and we're of the tribe of God. And so God has come and conquered our debt to sin by destroying the power of death, and now all of our names have been written in the book of life. And now the gospel is saying, come find your name written in the book of life. Come have your inheritance. Right? But not everybody wants eternal life. And God's not going to force eternal life on anybody. Okay? And so if you don't want eternal life, then what will happen is your name will then be blotted out of the book of life, and you can have your part in the second death, when God comes to destroy death. God isn't coming to kill some people, guys. He's not coming to kill people who don't want to believe on Him. He's coming to kill death, right? The Bible talks about it. Hosea chapter 13, verse 14 says, O death, I will be your plague. I will not repent from coming and killing you. It's like Wyatt Earp. I love that little clip, Wyatt Earp. You tell him I'm coming and I'm bringing hell with me. Okay, well, that's Jesus talking to death. And Jesus is saying to everyone and to death, I'm coming and I'm bringing heaven with me. And we're going to swallow death up and we're going to consume it once for all time. And we're going to live on a glorified creation with no sin and no death. And he's telling everybody, listen, man, don't make your lot with the second death. Come receive eternal life as a gift. I don't want you to do anything for it. You don't have to serve in the church to get it. You don't have to go to church every Sunday. You don't got to give a tithe. You don't got to be on the praise and worship team. You don't got to do any of that. Just all you got to do is say, I'll take it for free.
Praise God.
And so if there isn't that period of time, no one could be saved from death. Because if we're joined to death and Jesus comes back, when death goes, everything joined with death is going to be consumed also. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
That was a lengthy explanation, but that's a great question. And then the next time you listen to the message, keep your ears open for when I go into the Jubilee, because I talk about that. Yeah, that's why it says he's sitting at the right hand of God waiting for the last enemy to be made his footstool. The last enemy is death. Okay? And so that's why he's waiting. So all those who want eternal life can believe and then be saved from when death is cast into the lake of fire. Glory to God. Does somebody want to build or add on? Maurice.
Well, actually, this is something completely different. But I wanted to ask you, when you prayed earlier, you talked about, or you prayed that, you know, like we'd be delivered from a concept of God that so communicates to us a certain concept. I'm obviously paraphrasing.
Marred concept, I think.
A marred concept, thank you, of God that communicates something to ourselves. How does our concept of God communicate something to us that speaks ill of us or improperly of who we actually are?
That's a beautiful question, man. And flesh and blood has not caused you to ask that question, but our Father in heaven. Because that will, and we'll just lead that question into another question here so we can answer two at the same time. And I'll just read this question in light of that question. If somebody has the mic and just put it to mute and see if that doesn't quiet the storm. Alan, can we get you to quiet that storm, man? Be still. It might be me. I'm still trying to figure out how to quiet the storm that is Greg. God keeps telling me it's a storm full of rainbows and such. All right, anyway. We'll connect that question into what Maurice said. This is what the first question somebody asked. What is propitiation? What does it mean that Jesus is the propitiation for our sin if it isn't about appeasing God's anger? One of the ways God's image has gotten marred in our hearts is the way we've understood the cross has been from the foundation that God is filled with anger towards human beings because they disobeyed him or because they sinned. Okay? And then they say what God did was he had to satisfy his great dissatisfaction with human beings. And the way he did that was by sending his son so he could get all of his anger for human beings out on Jesus. Right? And thus, Jesus would be the appeasing of God's anger. Okay? And that's how we've described propitiation. As if Jesus appeased God's bloodlust towards human beings. As if God sat in heaven just so angry with man, so beside himself with man because they sinned, that he couldn't help himself but now come and take it out on Jesus. And so then we've described propitiation as God's anger being appeased. Now that mars God in our hearts because then we have an image of a God who isn't one who comes to save us because he loves us, but we have an image of a God who sent his son because he was so angry with us that he wanted to spank somebody, right? And so then that creates an image of almost like a Greek God or a Roman God or a pagan God. You guys notice all the pagan gods are also angry gods that need to be appeased, right? And then we describe them being appeased through human sacrifice, right? Well, that's not the way God did it. That's a perversion of what God did. See, God wasn't filled with anger towards human beings. He was filled with love. He didn't sit in a place where he was so dissatisfied with human beings because of their sin that he sent Jesus. He sat in a place where he looked at human beings even while they were dead in their sin, and he said, man, they're the treasure in the field. They're the pearl of great price. Their life is so beautiful. Their life is so valuable to me. I'm just so enamored with the fellowship I can have with them that I'm going to come and I'm going to conquer that which is killing them. You see, that creates two very different images of God, right? One is a God that's so filled with love in his heart for you because of the beauty he beholds that he come and laid down his life to save your life. That creates a pretty nice image. You ever notice how you feel about somebody that took your punishment for you? You ever notice how they look pretty good in your heart? I mean, I'll just think of my little brother. You know, my little brother and I didn't get along very well when we were younger because we're close in age. And, you know, I'm a little overbearing, you know, and there was no governor for Greg when Greg was a kid. And so Pat had to deal with Greg. And so we had a little bit of a sibling rivalry. Well, Pat actually loved me. And so Pat was all the time thinking, how can I demonstrate my love for Greg? Well, when Greg would go and do a bunch of bad things and Greg was due to get a punishment, Pat would come in and take the blame for what I had done. Or he would say it was him that did it. Or if we were both going to get punished or spanked because we were fighting, Pat would take the blame and say, no, it was me. I did it by myself. It wasn't him. And Pat would take the punishment and the blame for that onto himself. Even when he hadn't done anything, he'd lie sometimes and say he did it. Right? Now listen, what type of image do you think that presented in my heart? See, because I first sit with this image of Pat, who I think is against me, and I got to conquer him. But then I start realizing, man, this guy actually is only ever for me. So much so, he wants to take my punishment onto himself. Right? And so it started changing the image I had of Pat in my heart. And it's the same way with God. If you sit with an image of God and you think the heart behind the cross is that God had to get his anger out towards man, that's going to mar his image in your heart. It's going to make you have a tainted image of him where you can all the time think about the cross. You can all the time speak about the cross. You can all the time think of the sacrifice. But if you think the heart of God behind the sacrifice was one of anger, you're not going to experience the love. And you're going to have a marred image of God. You're all the time going to think, every time you see Jesus on the cross, you're not going to be thinking, there's God conquering my death. You're going to be thinking, oh my gosh, God was so angry with me because of what I did. That's what he did to Jesus? Listen, man, that's not going to give birth to a good image of God in your heart. And it's going to mar him. And, you know, a good friend in the ministry, Barty Britz, he does this powerful thing where he sticks the Roman centurion, a picture of the Roman centurions beating Jesus down when he's hung over the thing. And so you have these Roman centurions that's filled with all death. Just, if anybody's seen The Passion of the Christ, has everybody seen that? Remember that scene? What it looks like? He puts an image up there, and sometimes an image is more powerful than doctrine. And what he puts Jesus getting beat down, and then he shows the Roman centurions beating him down, and he says, okay, which one's God? Which one's filled with the Spirit of God? You see, we've preached the cross as if the centurions were filled with the Spirit of God. And they were beating down Jesus by inspiration of God. As if they were God in the picture. But God was the one taking the beating. He wasn't the one giving the beating. You see? And so from that standpoint, we start seeing a beautiful God. A God who loved us so much that he said, I can't stand the thought of them bearing the wages of sin. And so rather than them bearing the wages of sin, let me now become one of them. Let me become one of them and let me now take upon myself the wages of sin. That way I can conquer their death. And if I can conquer their death, then I can have my heart's desire, which is to live with them eternally in love. Now you see, when you describe God that way, it's a big difference than when you describe God as beating down Jesus. And see, there's a whole lot of people in the earth that can't believe in a God that would kill his son. We say God is love out of one breath, and then we say, yeah, he's love, but he killed his son. And we don't realize what that does to God in people's hearts. It mars his image. And it actually makes it impossible for them to trust God with their life. Because if they think that's what God did to Jesus, and Jesus was his only begotten son, my goodness, what's he going to do to me? He got it perfect, and he forsook him, and he afflicted him, and this, what is he going to do to me? See, now we're playing mind games with ourselves. And now we say, well, the scripture says he won't forsake me, he won't leave me. The scripture says he won't do that to me because he did it to him. But all the while, we'll be sitting thinking, listen, if that's what that guy's capable of, I don't know, man. That'd be like if you knew I was a serial killer and I come and told you, yes, 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 I did kill all those people, but man, I've repented. I'm no longer a serial killer. You're going to have me over to your house and go to sleep and leave me in there? You're going to let me come in there with your wife and your kids? I don't think so. Because in the back of your mind, you're going to think, I don't care what that guy says. I see that he tortured and butchered a bunch of people. And so, lest he fall off the horse, so to speak, and do the same thing to us. Let's keep him at arm's distance. And so we got God, you know, in that kind of image, as if God had to go to anger management classes so he could be set free from his anger. And so Jesus was his anger management classes. And now God got out all his anger, and now he's delivered from his anger. And so now we're supposed to invite that God into our house, but how do we know he's not going to fall off the horse again? How do we know he's not going to have a relapse? Right? What if he doesn't work the 12 steps to be free from your anger? Right? You see what I'm saying? All the while, we don't consider how this looks and or works in the human heart. And so I hope you guys can understand what I'm saying. And so I hope that answers your question, but do you want to add something to that? Just wait for it to kick back on if it hasn't yet.
Oh, am I on? Yeah. I thought you might say that. That's why I asked.
Hallelujah. And so just to cover propitiation, what's happened is we've thought of Jesus as the propitiation for our sin, as Jesus coming and appeasing God's anger towards us, right? But 1 John, I think it's chapter 2, says Jesus is the propitiation for the sin of the world. Doesn't say he's the propitiation for the anger of God. Doesn't say he's the appeasement of God's anger towards people. It says he's the appeasement of the sin of the world. And the sin of the world calls people to be in bondage to death. And so the way Jesus is the appeasement for sin is that he appeased sin because he took the wages of our sin into his own self. He took our death upon himself. And not only did he take our death upon himself, but he also satisfied God's desire to be good and kind to man, right? And so when we look at that, God never said to Adam, in the day you eat from that tree, I will require that you be punished and you die. It doesn't say that. It doesn't say God will require that Adam be punished and that Adam die. What God was saying is there is something that causes death, okay? And if you join yourself to what causes death, that thing will kill you. He didn't say, I will kill you. He didn't say, I will require your death. What he said was, there's something that brings death. Don't join yourself to it, man. Because if you join yourself to it, that thing will kill you. And so it's God's not like a government regulator sitting up there enforcing death on people. Okay? He's not sitting up there receiving paperwork and he says, well, I see Greg's sin, now let me bring some death. God's not the power behind sin's ability to bring death. I'm going to say that again. God is not the power behind sin's ability to bring death. He's not the source that behind sin that enables sin to bring death. And I think we think that he is. It's like we think sin can bring death because God's the one that makes it bring the death. But the wages of sin being death is just talking about something that's true. kind of like the law of gravity. You know, every time I walk outside of my house, God doesn't say, well, I see Greg's walked outside of his house. Let me make gravity work. Let me make gravity work. It's not every time I walk outside my house, God says, oh, let's make gravity work. There's just a truth that causes gravity to work, right? And so it's the same way. There's just a truth that there's only one life. That life is in God. There is no life outside of God. Okay? It's just a fact. He's the only one that has life. So in the day I want life outside of God, or I reject the life he wants to give me as a free gift, and I want to try to have life through my own ability, I want to try to have life separate from God giving it to me for free, the result of that is death. Not because God's a petulant child and says, takes his ball home because you don't want to play the game like he wants to play. It's just a bona fide fact. He's the only one with life. And so if you don't want life from him, there is no life outside of him. And so if you try to have life outside of him, the result of that is death. Does everybody understand that? It's just a truth. It's not God sitting up in the throne and saying, I'm going to make sin bring death. That's what we think it is. It's just a truth. Does everybody see the difference there? So what happened, guys, is that when Adam ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, sin entered the world. When Adam ate from the tree that brings death, he tried to find life outside of God. Because there's no life outside of God, death was able to enter him. God didn't come and say, well, I see you ate from the tree, here's some death. That's not what happened. He ate from a tree. That tree found an opportunity to manifest death in him. Okay? Because that tree can't give life. Is everybody following that? So propitiation is God coming and through the person of Jesus and taking the wages of our sin into himself in order that the wages of our sin could be appeased in his body, in order that the wages of our sin could come to pass in him, in order that the wages of our sin could be satisfied in his body on the cross, so that the wages of sin could be appeased, which is death. Okay? The Bible makes it real clear. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. James says every good and perfect gift comes from above. Is death good and perfect? Then how can we say it came from God? And so sin brings death. Jesus came and appeased the death that sin brought all of us. Okay? That's part of propitiation. And then the next part of the question they asked is, why does Isaiah say God saw the travail of Jesus on the cross and was satisfied? Why does God say he saw the suffering and affliction of Jesus on the cross and felt satisfied? How did Jesus appease God if he wasn't appeasing his anger? That's a very good question. Glory to God for these guys' questions. And so this is how we have to look at it. What would make God satisfied? You have to first understand, what is it that God desires? God has always desired to be good and kind to man. Always desired that. Even before they sinned and they found themselves clothed in all death. He's only ever sat with the desire in his heart to be good and kind to man. He's always been full of goodness and favor towards man, even while they were dead in their sin. And so he sent Jesus to die away the death that was reigning over us. Okay? Now, something interesting about the word propitiation. The word propitiation comes from a root word, propitious. You know what propitious means? I mean, I think most of us are connecting it already. Does the word propitious sound like somebody being angry with somebody else? The word propitiation comes from the root propitious. This is what it means. To be full of goodness and favor towards another. It means to be propitious towards another, to be gracious towards another, to be merciful to another. It means to conciliate another to oneself. That's propitiation. So God sat with the desire to be good and kind to man. He wanted to be good and kind to man. He looked at man dead in their sin and he said, well, this doesn't change my desire to be good and kind to man. I still want to be good and kind to man, but I look at man and I see that they're enslaved to sin and death. And so the way I'm going to be good and kind to man is I'm going to come and I'm going to absorb the wages of their sin into myself. And then I'm going to raise up myself out of the grave and I'm going to be free from sin and death. And that's how I'll be good and kind to man. I'll conquer the death that was conquering my people. And so that's why the death of Jesus satisfied God. Because he had a desire to be good and kind to man. And Jesus came and Jesus conquered our death. He absorbed our sin into himself. And that satisfied God's desire to be good and kind to us. Do you see? God wanted to be propitious. He saw the way he could be propitious is by conquering our death. Jesus came, he conquered our death. And in conquering our death, he could reconcile all things back unto God, whether in heaven or in earth. He could reconcile the world back to himself. And so that could once again satisfy God's desire to be good and kind to man. Do you see that's a whole big difference than God's anger being appeased? So God didn't desire to take out his anger on humans. He didn't sit with a heart full of anger towards humans and think, how can I appease this desire? He sat with the desire to be good and kind to man. And then he thought, how can I satisfy this desire to be good and kind to man? I know man is suffering at the hands of sin and death. I'll come as their David and I'll conquer their Goliath. I'll destroy that death that's destroying my people. So Jesus came and did that, and the Father was satisfied. Right? You see how that creates two big differences. Guys, if I'm just being honest, one of the biggest things that's changed my life with God is seeing the difference in that. Because at the beginning of my life with God, I thought God was so angry with me, he did that to Jesus. And he forsook Jesus. That wrecked my heart, and I didn't even realize it. Right? And now, since I've seen God's heart actually behind sending Jesus, I find that all the years I spent trying to trust God and never really being able to, I found him giving birth to trust in me by revealing what his heart always was. And now I just find myself going to rest in the beauty of God and his intentions towards me. If that makes any sense. Now, if anybody wants to...
That's how it affects us. That's how having a proper view of God affects us. Because when we see that of him, and I mean truly see that in our hearts, it produces that in us. And it's conversely, it's true also. If we see God as an angry, vengeful God looking at our actions and not separating us from our sins, we see other people like that way. That's in that same fashion.
Amen. And what Maurice just said needs to go into the church worldwide. I think a lot of the people who haven't believed on God, they don't see a church that's filled with love. They see a church filled with judgment and hate and anger. And so they say, forget that God. And what the church doesn't realize is what Maurice just said. The reason they find themselves filled with hate and anger and judgment towards the world is because they think that's what God was filled with towards them. And so they're being born from a corruptible image of God. And so that's why the church is completely ineffective in the world. Because they come teaching about the anger of God. And how God's going to kill some people. And all this kind of stuff. And God hated us so much, look what he did. And God had to forsake Jesus so he could accept us. Listen, man, that does not bring forth trust in the hearts of human beings. And then what happens is it gives birth to a thought in church people where if they see somebody in sin, they feel anger. Right? What's wrong with them? They're rejecting God. They're rebelling against God. And then they feel like the Sons of Thunder or John or whatever. Was it the Samaritans or I can't remember what town it was that rejected Jesus? And they said, shall we call down fire upon them so they can be consumed? And what did Jesus say? You don't know what spirit you're of, buddy. The Son of Man didn't come to kill people. He came to save their lives. And so the church, man, they need to get the revelation of what we're talking about here. So we can start explaining this God to the world. And not just explaining this God to them, but so they can start feeling that God coming out of us towards them. Right? Sinners were drawn to Jesus. Jesus didn't go hunting them out. The church is hunting out the sinners. The sinners aren't hunting out the church. You know why? Because they don't feel from the church what people felt from Jesus when he walked around the earth. Jesus didn't judge anyone. Jesus even said, I condemn no man. Jesus said that. I condemn no one. So glory to God. That's a great question. And I hope that makes sense to everybody, yeah. Guys. So Easter Sunday, mm-hmm. when we show up and they show us all the brutality that happened to Jesus, let this dwell in your heart. Amen. That didn't come from the Father. Amen. That was the Father in Christ taking the beating that come from our sin. Mm-hmm. To set us free because he loves us. The Bible says God was in Christ reconciling the world. He didn't leave Christ and then beat on Christ. He was in Jesus, strengthening Jesus to rest in the midst of that death. Do you know why? You know how he strengthened Jesus to rest in the midst of that death? I'll never leave or forsake you. It's not by your strength you'll conquer this death. I will uphold you. You are my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. I will not allow this death to conquer you, but I will conquer this death. I will raise you from the grave. I am with you. This is what was in Jesus' heart from the Father while he was dying. And that's how he could take it, man. You see, but we say, oh, the Father couldn't look upon Jesus. He looked at Jesus and thought, ugh. But what we don't realize, guys, is we're created to identify with Jesus. And so if we think that's how the Father looked on Jesus, now the image we have of ourselves are marred in our own hearts. Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah. Now we think we're a worm. We think we're disgusting. We think we're an abomination to God. We think we're the forsaken of God. Listen, man, if you're hearing that voice, it ain't from God. Amen. I don't care what you think you're busy with. That ain't the voice of the Father. The voice of the Father is, neither do I condemn you. God has justified you. You know, I think sometimes we get confused about the accusation. We think the accusation was that we did wrong. That wasn't the accusation. The accusation of the serpent is, mankind isn't your children. The evidence was the death we had. That's the accusation. The accusation is man isn't yours. They don't come from you. Look, they have death and you have life. And so when God raised Jesus from the dead, he justified mankind. He had to do something to justify mankind. He had to release a truth that if human beings could believe, that truth would then strengthen them in the inner man. So when God raised Jesus from the dead, Jesus had all sin and all death upon him. And when God raised Jesus from the dead, he was refuting the accusation that man wasn't from him. He was conquering the lie. He was saying, I know the accusation is that you're not mine, you're not my people, that you're not my children, and I know the evidence is your body of death, but watch this. I'm going to go take a human being who has your death, and I'm going to raise that human being up. Do you know what it means when he raised that human being up? It was him declaring, he is my son. We all thought he wasn't the son of God. What was the accusation against Jesus at the cross? He's not the son. What was the accusation against all of us? We're not the children of God. So God said, let's flip the script. Let's come uproot and destroy that thing. We'll take the sin and death of the whole world. We'll put it on one man. Everybody will say he's not the son. Everybody will hear the accusation against him. And then I'm going to come and claim him as mine. I'm going to raise him from the dead. I'm going to put him on display. And that will declare to the whole world that the accusation that they haven't come from me is a lie. When you find out where you come from, guess what happens? You yearn to go home. Guys, I lived in Colorado for a lot of years. It's beautiful there. It's wonderful. I snowboarded like a maniac for years. Out of bounds, did crazy things. Sat up at 13,000 feet just looking at blizzards by myself thinking, ah, this is nice. Surfing down the snow in trees and everything. Listen, I had a yearning to come home. You see, every human being has wired within them a yearning to come home, to be with the ones they love and to be with the ones they know love them. When I came home, it was a special thing, man, because I was gone all the time. When I would come home for Christmas or Thanksgiving, man, my family would treat me like I was the freaking prodigal. Man, Greg, come home. Yeah, it was like the greatest thing ever. It's like we all desire to belong to someone. And we desire that they want to belong to us. Man, we have that in God. And so God come to justify human beings as his. Don't get it twisted. You all come from me. You're all my children. Come home. And see, we don't understand justification. We only see one aspect of it. And so we don't understand the first aspect of it. In order for us to be strengthened in the inner man through faith, there has to first be a faith we can hear and believe. The faith we first hear and believe is that we are the children of God. And this body of death doesn't now mean we didn't come from him. Then that strengthens us to come home. Because we see we've had a yearning to belong to someone. And then we hear from God that we belong to him. And not only that we belong to him, but that he has a yearning to belong with us. And then that makes us get our plane ticket and fly across the world and come home, man. Glory to God. Sorry, I went off on a tangent.
I just wanted, can I share?
Hi, this is Beth, everybody. Hi, Beth.
Good morning, everybody.
Beth works at Stark in Mandeville, guys.
Yes, I do. Yeah, it's a great place.
Hallelujah.
Just want to share on a comment with Maurice was saying about the image, and it just stuck with me when you're trying to find the words, that marred image, when Greg was praying in a prayer earlier. That's what I had. I said, yeah, a marred image of God and a marred image of myself. But every day now, I'm so thankful to God for the revelation that we receive here at Gospel Revolution, which has confirmed just God's dealing with me about how much he does love me and how much he does love man. And now coming here just continually confirms that word, and to keep hearing that word, it just keeps, you know, me focus on the faith of, you know, that God has given to us. So I'm thankful to God for that. It allows me to rest in God and to be able to share with other people that, you know, God is not coming from a place of anger. And I was thinking today in church, when Greg was sharing, is the image that I grew up with and was taught in the church reminded me of, I guess, that book, or Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. That's the teaching that I came up with for so many years until the Holy Spirit began to just talk to me. And things I would hear, one thing in a Bible study once in church, the pastor was saying, well, I stand between you and God, you know, man and God. And just clear as a bell, and I know it was the Holy Spirit, just wouldn't let me receive that. Say, no, there is one God, and there is only one mediator between man and God, and that's the man Christ Jesus. It's not any man or any doctrine of man that he can share to come up with to say, hey, I stand between you and God, and if you're not meeting this expectation, then you're not, you know, meeting up to the measure that God wants you to come to. And that just kept me, even after being saved and experiencing the love of God at the new birth. But then afterward, all of these rules and regulations, I got to do this to keep that love, or, you know, maintain that love, or for God to love me more than what he loved me yesterday. So it's just so confusing. So that just totally marred my image of God and myself. But I thank God for the truth and in the light and his grace that had been revealed, you know, to us. That's my comment. My question on has to do with the question that, what's her name again? Your sister?
Michelle.
Yeah, had earlier with, and you're talking about the times of Jubilee, what we're going through now. Is that the same as when the scripture speaks of the fullness of the times of the Gentiles having to be fulfilled?
I would say that's connected with it, yes. Okay. I would see we're in the period of time now where the fullness of the Gentiles are coming in.
Okay.
That's part of the Jubilee. Yes, absolutely. Amen. And that's wonderful what you just said and the clarity you brought to it. It actually reveals what the law system will do to us. a list of rules and regulations. If we sit with the standard that tells us we got to meet that to be beautiful to God or to be pleasing to God, those standards start acting like a big punching glove whopping us in the nose, whopping us in the side of the face. Every time we don't meet the standard, we just took another blow. Boom, boom, boom. And this is in our hearts. Before we know it, we sit with the image in our hearts of Rocky Balboa after he got beat down by Apollo Creed, right? And that's what the law system does. Man, it'll hit you so many times that you'll never be able to believe God loves you because you'll sit with an image in your heart that's just ugly. And God come to wash our conscience clean from that system. He come to wash our conscience clean from judging ourselves by what we see manifesting in our lives, by what we do, by what we get, by what we have. And he come to fill our consciences with what he's always believed about us. And then we begin to know ourselves even as we're known by God. And then we become happy. And I mean, there's so much beauty in what you just said, Beth. I mean, you see, Beth didn't need the person to be getting it right for the Holy Spirit to tell her that ain't right. Right? And Beth didn't need Greg to come tell her that God loved her for her to already know. All Greg came and did was confirmed what the Holy Spirit was already telling her. That's all I did. And that's how a prophet works. He don't come and tell you things you didn't know. He comes and confirms the still small voice of the Father that was already in your heart. And then you get happy because you think it's true, man. Right? Because sometimes you can feel like Elijah. Lord, I'm the only one. You can feel like you're a maniac. How can it be true that I'm believing God? I hear God telling me he loves me all the time, but every time I go to church, I hear I'm an abomination. I hear in my heart that God's loved me with an everlasting love, that he'll only be good to me, that he's already blessed me freely in Christ, but then I go to church and I hear the opposite. And so sometimes you can feel like, which one is true? And then God will just send someone along that will confirm the truth in your heart. And you'll be strengthened to know, it's the truth, man. Glory to God. If that makes any sense. Thank you so much for sharing, Beth. Anyway.
While y'all were talking, I kind of got just a picture of a parent, father, you know, telling their kid not to play out in the street, you know, basically just, you know, because a car could come by and, you know, essentially, you know, run it down, kill it, or hurt it. And then one day he's looking out the window and there his kid is out in the street playing, and he's horrified. He's running out the door just in the nick of time to shove the kid out of the way of an oncoming car. Takes the blow himself, but saves the child. You know, you can't sit with that picture in your heart and think that that father was not for that child.
Amen. That's it. That's good. That's good. Jay. Beth, can you hand the microphone to Jay? Guys, this is Jacinta. She goes by Jay. Hi, Jay.
Hi. Oh, it doesn't really have to do with anything, but I'm just so excited sitting here, like, how she was talking about how the revelation and, you know, the mirror image being gone and everything. And, well, yesterday my mother called me because she's been posting, like, scriptures. And I will repost them, and then I'll explain it. And I thought she was going to kill me. So sometimes I just don't even touch the scripture, whatever she posts. But she called me yesterday, and she was so excited. She's like, oh, my goodness. Those are so nice. You know? I'm like, oh, my gosh. Because I go radical when I explain it. I go, oh, and she's like, I'm, like, so excited, like, beyond, and to hear that, you know, how effective the mar image really, you know, really does just mar the image of who God really is. And I'm just so excited for my mom to be, you know, for that to be clearing up for her as well. So.
Amen. And for me, that's an example of the next question we'll get to from online, unless somebody else jumps in. That's an example of God being a light to people we love through us without us even knowing it, right? She's posting verses. Those verses are actually touching your life. And so she feels that she's touching your life. And then you're explaining the verses, and then that's touching her life, right? And that's working to make straight whatever had gotten crooked in her heart. Not really with you even trying. Are you thinking, I got to set somebody free? But just by it happening effortlessly, right? Glory to God. Does anybody want to jump in before we jump to the next question? Or does anybody have a question themselves? Man, Alan, I just can't get off this thing with you. Be still. man. I can just see like this silent voice that's going to come out of you, man, and people are going to hear it, but in their hearts and not really with their ears. And it's going to be like when Moses was parting the Red Sea, and he said, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. And man, I just see your whole family going into that. That thing is going to be born in you. And it's first going to happen in you, where you guys are going to find yourself standing still and seeing the salvation of the Lord in your life. But then what's going to happen is that word's going to be made flesh in you. And people aren't going to hear the stand still and see the salvation of the Lord from you speaking it. They're going to see it born in your life. And they're just going to be beholding it in your life. And it's going to bring quietness to people's hearts, man. I just feel something inside myself filled with joy every time I just look over there. Glory to God. I keep saying the same thing. Nelly. Jay, can you hand Nelly the mic? Guys, this is Nelly. Hi, Nelly. Yeah, make sure it's on real quick. Oh, yeah, we got a winner.
Yeah, can y'all hear me?
Yes.
All right. I had a question, and a comment, too. I'm going to say the comment because I love the way when I studied, you know, like studying the Word, you know, like meditating, and it's like it filling me with so much happiness and hope and a lot of revelations. Especially to hear the, you know, the word in Genesis, I believe it's like 3, let me see, there's 7 right here. Give me a second, I can't see. I need to put my glasses.
That's fine.
Yeah, 3:27. I mean, let me see. 3a. Sorry. When I hear, and they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. I love to hear that because it fills me with so much, hope, and it gives me a lot of, made me feel really happy about it just to hear that the God, when he approached Adam and Eve, they heard him. And they say they heard him and they hid. But the thing about it is that we're looking at like in our life, it's like that he was coming to judge us. But the judge that he feel was the love that he had for us. And my question is, when I read that, it say like they heard the voice of the Lord walking in the cool of the day. Do the Father was talking to the Son, or he was talking to somebody more out, like the angels? That's my question.
So I just want to make sure I got it right. When it says that they heard the voice of God in the cool of the day, you want to know if God was talking directly to them? Or if he was talking to somebody else.
That's my question. I know that when they heard the voice, you know, my question is, do he was talking to the Son, or he was talking to angels, or they was, you know, they heard him, because this in a verse say that they hid when they heard him. So my question was, you know, the Father was talking to the Son and the Holy Spirit, or he was talking, because when you hear somebody talking, to me, it's like somebody more, like more people around.
Yeah, and I think that's a very good comment that you make there. There were more people around because Elohim is Father, Son, and Spirit. Mm-hmm. And what I would say is, just like Elohim said, let us make man in our image and our likeness, Elohim was more or less saying, let us talk with Adam and Eve. And so I would say with one voice, the Father, Son, and Spirit have always been having a conversation with each other. And then they started having that conversation with Adam and Eve, right? And it talks about the cool of the day, because I think it talks about the place from where we hear the voice of God talking with us. You know, when our consciences are filled with laboring and toiling, notice when Adam ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, God said, by the sweat of your brow, now you'll bring forth fruit. He was talking about now that your conscience has been filled with laboring and toiling, you're going to struggle to really hear what I want to say to you and how I'm going to give you life and I'm your food for life, but you're going to be filled with laboring and toiling, trying to bring forth life through your own ability. Okay, so when it talks about the cool of the day, it speaks of an innocence, right? It speaks of a person's conscience that hasn't been corrupted by the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And because it hasn't been corrupted by the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they hear the voice of God that's always talking to them very clearly, right? But I would say, yeah, they're having a conversation with each other. But with human beings, we tend to only see one side of a thing and struggle to understand the whole thing. But what I would say is God was having a conversation with themselves, but also with Adam at the same time, right? And it worked at the same time in the same way. So Adam and Eve would have heard them talking to themselves, but they also would have been talking to each other, right? If you can understand what I'm saying there. Does that make sense? And I love walking in the cool of the day. I preached a whole message, just so you know, called Walking in the Cool of the Day. And I love it. And that's ultimately what will happen with us. We can experience that now. We have our conscience washed clean from laboring and toiling to exalt ourselves or to believe that we're the God kind. And then we begin hearing the voice of God now. We stop laboring and toiling to be acceptable. We stop laboring and toiling to bring forth life. We begin walking in the cool of the day. We're no longer sweating from our brow. And we hear the voice of God real easily. Because God is talking to us from the foundation of our innocence. He's talking to us from the foundation of the beauty he beholds in us. He's not talking to us from the foundation of him thinking we're ugly or him thinking we're not acceptable, right? And so if that's the foundation we're trying to hear God from, man, we might not hear exactly what he's saying, right? But don't fret. If you're struggling to hear God, he'll send someone along that'll tell you what he's saying to you in your face, right? So if you're struggling to believe you're beautiful to God, man, hear ye the voice of God today. He finds so much beauty in you that when he looked at you, the thoughts he had about you filled his heart with love and joy. Okay? That's it. And then we'll finish up with this last question if everybody's okay. And this is a good question, and probably a lot of people will have some things to say about this. This is the question. How do we handle it if someone we love is in darkness in a certain area? Or how do we handle it if somebody we love is struggling with something in the world or struggling with something? What do we do about that? How can we handle that? And I think the question is just asking from along the lines of, man, if we love people and we're filled with compassion for them, how can we walk with them? How can we be of help to them when they're in that place of darkness? And I don't just mean unbelievers. There's a lot of times you could have already believed you could be walking through a hard time, right? And you could be struggling with something. And so the question is, how do we handle that? What do we do? And I think the end goal of the question is we just want to be the greatest help that we can, and we don't want to be a hindrance. And I think that's a very good question. It's actually one of the areas we can be the most tempted to enlist our own ability, right? We can be the most tempted to try to get in there and fix the problem. You know what I'm saying? And the reason why is because we can sit with this love and compassion in our hearts for their life. And we sit with the pure thought where we only love them. We only want the best for them. We have a desire for them to experience freedom and joy and life. And then from that foundation, we kind of succumb to thinking we got to jump in there and make it better. We got to jump in there and fix it. We got to jump in there and take care of the problem. And then what happens real quickly is our desire for them to experience life and freedom quickly turns into us taking the burden of bringing it forth in ourselves, right? Whatever we do in the lives of the people we love, we don't want it to be born from fear. We don't want it to be born from the foundation of us being fearful for their lives, okay? We want it to be born from the foundation of seeing God has preserved their life eternally in Christ. And there's nothing wrong with having a desire to see them set free. There's nothing wrong with having that desire, but what are we doing with that desire? Okay? And the thing we want to do with that desire is when we have a desire for the ones we love to be delivered from whatever darkness they have or whatever thing we see afflicting them, we don't want to take that burden onto ourselves and think we got to now bring forth it in their life. Okay? We want to commit that desire into the hands of God. Okay? That's how we deal with it. So if we feel love and compassion for them, we feel we want them to be set free from whatever affliction they have, we see we want the light to shine into their darkness. We don't now take that desire and say, how are we going to do it? Or let us now fix the problem. Okay? What we do is we realize we have that desire in our heart because God had the desire. And the way we handle that desire is we don't try to bring it about, but we commit it into the hands of God. Right? Father, into your hands I commit my desire for my spouse, for my kids, for my loved ones, for my friends, for whoever. Into your hands I commit my desire for them to be set free from this affliction, for the light to shine into their darkness. And see, what happens then is, instead of you taking the burden on yourself, you've now allowed God to take the burden on himself. And that will deliver you from any type of fear, and that will set you free to actually just be with them in their darkness. Actually, the best thing you can do to help anybody you love when they're in darkness isn't to try to fix them, but to just be with them there. Right? To just be with them where they're at. And not from the foundation of, I gotta try to fix you, or I gotta try to fix this, or we gotta try to fix that. Just sit with them in their darkness, and cast your care about their life onto God. What'll happen is the love and compassion of God will shine out of you with them in their darkness accidentally. And God will minister to their hearts, apart from you even realizing they're being ministered to. Because the greatest thing a person can feel when they're being afflicted, or they're suffering affliction, or they're experiencing darkness, is to feel love and compassion. And not to feel judgment or condemnation. And so what did God do with us when we were in darkness? And when we were affliction? He entered our darkness and sat with us there. He didn't say, let me now fix them. He came and sat with us where we're at. And he said, let them feel my love and my compassion for them. Because what happens is, guys, if we take the burden of trying to fix them onto ourselves, or if we take the burden of trying to bring forth life in them onto ourselves, what's going to happen is we're not going to be filled with love and compassion towards them. We're going to set ourselves up under a law of we must fix them. Then we'll begin judging ourselves by whether or not we're doing a good job of fixing them. Then we'll also put them under the law of they must get better. And then we'll start judging them by whether or not they're getting better. Okay? That doesn't give birth to love and compassion. That gives birth to bitterness and resentment on both parties. The one in darkness won't feel love and compassion. They'll feel judgment and condemnation. They'll begin resenting you, even though your desire started off as pure. Right? You'll also begin resenting them, because you'll have them under a law of they must get better. And at first, you might try harder to make them better, but the moment you don't think you see them getting better, you're going to start feeling things like, they just don't want to get better. What's wrong with them? You see? Because now you're judging yourself by whether or not they're getting better. Because you're under a law of, I must make them better. And so now you're judging your goodness by if they're getting better or not. So if you don't see them get better at first, you might try harder. And it might look real good. I'm trying harder. You'll feel real good. Boy, I'm really working this thing. Hallelujah. But then all of a sudden, you don't think you see anything change. Then the law you put yourself under will judge you. And then you'll judge them. They just don't want to get better. They don't want to know God. They're rebelling against God. Listen, man, that ain't love and compassion. Right? And so listen, I understand this from personal experience, painful personal experience, because I tend to be, the way God manifests out of me is truth. And so there's something in me that swallows up lies and just always wants to declare the truth, the truth, the truth. It just comes out of me all the time. That's how I am. That's how I talk with God. But I've learned that even though there could be a truth that can set them free, if I'm all the time busy trying to truth, instead of just loving and being with the person, it has a negative effect sometimes. Because they don't feel like you're just being with them and loving them as they are. They feel like you're trying to fix them so you can love them. Do you guys see what I'm saying? It's a big difference. And so what God will do is if he can wash your conscience clean from taking on the burden and you commit your desire for their life to be upheld by him, you'll be set free from worrying about their life and you'll be strengthened in the inner person to sit with them in their darkness and to just be, you'll find the love and compassion of God pouring out of you towards them. And that will actually be a much better foundation than you just trying to hit them with a bunch of truth bombs. Because when they feel love and compassion coming out of you, and they feel you just being with them where they're at, and just loving on them, they're going to engage you in a conversation eventually. And then the Father can come out of you. And if there is something to say or something to do, if you've cast the burden onto God, God will quicken it inside of you. And you'll feel God in you knowing what to do. It might just be to hug them and tell them they're beautiful, man. They're beautiful just the way they are. That God's not trying to fix them, that God's accept. It might just be that, and you're hugging them. I hope that makes some kind of sense. And I'll use my dad as an example, and then we'll jump to this last part of this question. But when I was a teenager, I walked in all darkness. I was a drug addict. I wasn't just a drug addict. I sold drugs. I did every drug there was, as much as you could imagine doing it. I was the walking dead. Dead man walking. I was only 10, 11, 12 years old, guys. I OD'd on a hospital bed when I was 12 from a drug overdose. Okay? My heart stopped beating. I had to be resuscitated. Now, what do you think my parents felt like? Watching me in that darkness. You know, and the temptation was for them to try to fix my life. That's what the wisdom of the world said. And many of the people around us came to them and said, you got to give them tough love, man. You got to kick them out. You got to get rid of them. That's the wisdom of the world. You got to get in there and fix it. Here's how you do it. You see, but God brought something else alive inside of my parents where God come and told my dad, no, man, tough love isn't kicking them out and judging them for where they're at. Tough love is just being with them in their darkness. That's much more difficult. Right? And ironically, I say ironically because the carnal mind doesn't grasp that. That's actually much more powerful than anything. Because I never felt rejected by my parents. Even in the midst of all this horrible things I was doing, I never felt separated from their love. I never felt them judging me or abandoning me or thinking that I was despicable or disgusting or a loser. See, that stayed in my heart, and what it acted was a light in my life. Right? That eventually I had something to come back to. And before we take anything else in on that, we were, you know, in the men's Bible study, we had a great talk about something along these lines. And Jim, I don't want to put you on the spot, but I do, because what you said was so good. And so just speak from your heart. But Jim said something powerful in the men's group we were talking a couple weeks ago. He said there's a difference between being responsible to someone and being responsible for someone. And Jim, if you don't mind, if you can grab a mic, if you don't have anything to say, don't feel obligated. But if you feel something coming to you about that, that'd be great. I think it is.
Well, I don't know. I guess the example that, that I think about, I have a friend who's much older. I think he's probably 90 something now, and he and his wife were of another faith, if you know what I mean. And his daughter, who's very well-meaning, was really worried about her mom and dad, that they were kind of going down the wrong track and needed to do something to bring him to Jesus. And so she told me one day, she said, I've given them a Bible, and I hope they'll read it. And I said, baby, that's probably the worst thing in the world you could have done for them. Because what are they going to do with it, you know? And so anyway, we talked about the difference between being responsible to them. Being responsible to them, like you're talking about, is going to sit with them and not being their judge. Being responsible for them means that I have to go and make it right for them. I have to go and make them right. And all that's going to do is create a lot of frustration on both parts. In my own life, there are some people that I'm close to, and I may not be the one to really share Christ with them. But I have just given it over to God. And so I'm with them. I don't preach to them. I don't try to. And I think that's being responsible too. Because the moment I think I'm responsible for somebody, then I have to control them. Mm. And it winds up controlling me.
Mm. That's good. That's good. And see, guys, the carnal mind says, well, then nothing will happen if I don't do something. It's like we discount the power of God to do something. What happens is man, if we just, like Jim just so beautifully said, if we just see that we're responsible to them, just to be with them wherever they're at, and we commit it into God's hands. God cares about their life much more than we do, guys, as much as we think we do. God cares about their life much more than we do. If we commit it unto him and we just allow ourselves to walk with them through life, man, we can find the life of God manifesting out of us towards them in whatever way it needs to, right? And that's the best way for it to happen, is for us just to walk with people and not take the responsibility for their life onto ourselves or the responsibility to fix their life. And I could just hear God saying, who told you that it's your responsibility to save their life? Who told? Has the Father now come down and said, boy, I see what's happening here, and man, I'm real anxious about it. If we don't do something, I don't know what we'll do. No, seriously, that's how we all act, isn't it? Because we feel pressed in on and we don't know how to deal with it. But listen, God's not anxious about their life. He's not busy thinking, what are we going to do? He's not busy thinking, well, unless I can get you to now swoop into action and take responsibility for their life and save their life, all is lost. I think sometimes we feel that way because we feel pressed in on by the affliction and the darkness. We feel pressed in on by our loving compassion for them, and we don't know how to process it. Right? But God's not the one who's come down and said, you got to do something. What are we going to do? God hasn't come down and had a powwow with you and said, man, do you see what's going on? You better do something. Jim.
You know, I was a pastor in a church back in the 80s. And after getting out of seminary, I think I had this heavy burden of feeling like God had called me to reach the lost. And so I became responsible for people. And after 8 years, it finally drove me in the ground. And I think that's what happens with most, and I hate to say it like this, but most churches are, they give the impression of we are responsible to get you into heaven. So you need to come here and be a part of us and speak our language and do what we do and listen to the messages on Sunday. So come and be a part of it. Learn what your gift is so that you can serve, and I mean, on and on and on. So we put this incredible burden on people, and we cause them to think that they're responsible for the salvation of other people. So the only thing they know to do is when there's a problem, they tell their friends, well, come go to church with me. So they come go to church. And what do they hear? You know, the same thing. And so it's just not our responsibility.
Amen.
God's taken that on himself, and he's done a very good job at it.
Amen.
So, you know,
God is not lacking.
Yeah.
And I love how he connected it to the church, because a lot of the times the reason why we feel we got to swing into action is because that's the mindset going on in the church. But if you notice, the church tries to control people, more or less, because they've taken the burden of people's salvation on themselves. As if it isn't enough to just introduce a person to the one who loves their souls, who's the everlasting Romeo searching them out, and just let them start walking with God, and let God just sit with them and be with them, and let it happen that way. Man, I think we'll find so many good things out of that, because if I'm just being honest, my own life, something comes against my own life, I care very little nowadays. Because for me, it's like, oh man, God's preserved my life eternally. The hope of glory is in me through Christ. Hallelujah. But man, I tend to feel more pressed in on by when I see my loved ones being afflicted. And the greater temptation for me is to enlist my ability to try to help my loved one. Listen, Paul said, no good thing dwells in the flesh. So the moment you try to enlist your ability to deliver your loved ones, listen, it can't bring forth any good thing. There's one who's good. His name is Abba. The best thing you can do is just walk with them wherever they're at and let Abba walk it with them and sort it out. And through you casting your care, if Abba is trying to say anything or wants to manifest through you in any kind of way, you'll do it from a place of love and compassion and not fear. And it's a good way to look at it. If what you're doing is out of fear and anxiousness, it cometh not from God. Because God is not fearful or anxious about a person's life. And so if you feel great peace and love and compassion and you don't feel any judgment, man, you know you're hearing from God. And if there should be anything that can be said or that needs to be said, you can just know God will give it to you. Right? You'll hear clearly. You don't have to wonder, does something need to be said or done? God knows what needs to be done. He knows how to do it. He knows the perfect time to do it. So stop thinking about it or taking it onto yourself, commit it unto God, and trust God to bring forth whatever in you needs to come forth whenever it needs to come forth, apart from your much figuring or you thinking something needs to be done. Sometimes us trying to do something is the worst thing that could ever be done. We're actually inserting ourselves, like Beth so beautifully pointed out, we're making ourselves the mediator between them and God. We're actually getting in the way. Because, man, listen, guys, sometimes God's busy doing something in a person's heart, and he's so far along in setting them free from their darkness, we don't even know. And then we come and get in the way. I mean, Jim said something powerful to me. I know I was in darkness in an area of my life, getting up on stage and preaching. And, you know, the temptation is for people, they see me and they love me, and their temptation is to try to come in and save me from what they feel. You know, but Jim said something powerful to me. He said, listen, man, I can see that you're dying up there unto something in this world that's been trying to kill you. And I'm not going to take you off the cross. Now, see, that don't make sense to the carnal mind. But it made a whole lot of sense in my heart. The worst thing Jim could have tried to do was try to insert himself to save me from the pain it looked like I was going through. You see, but he knew God had me. And so he could have compassion and love for me in that place, realizing all the time, even if he sees me flapping around like a fish sometimes, God isn't far from me and God has me. And from that place, he could allow the Spirit of the Son to do what it's doing in me, which was making the persuasion in my heart conformable to the death I died with Christ. And that's actually the place where you find salvation, when you die to the lie. But if we're all trying to keep people from dying to the lie, how are they ever going to die to that which is bringing them darkness? So let us just know God has their life. Their life is in God's hands, and God don't need us to fix it. Let us just be with them. Let us recognize the beauty God sees in them. And let's just walk with them where they're at. Let's just walk together. Hallelujah. Jim.
This will be kind of quick. If I believe that my role in other people's lives is to see Christ in them, then that changes everything.
I was going to also say, kind of where you were going, where we can make things worse. When somebody's under condemnation, that kind of makes the situation worse. And so if we're constantly putting somebody under condemnation, thinking we're helping, we're actually pushing them in the wrong direction.
Yeah.
They're not going to be coming for help. They're going to be going back the other direction.
Yeah. The serpent's already trying to bring condemnation. Right. You know what I'm saying? The serpent's already trying to condemn them and accuse them. Let us realize that it's the serpent that condemns and accuses and judges with an unrighteous judgment. It's the serpent that comes and points and says, look at you. So let us realize that's the serpent that does that and not the Father. so that we don't find ourselves lining up over there with the serpent and pointing the finger, right? I mean, who was it that we have a perfect example of this with the woman caught in adultery. Who represented God and who represented the voice of the serpent? You have the Pharisees there condemning the woman, don't we? Well, who represented God, Jesus or the Pharisees? Who was judging the woman with an unrighteous judgment? The Pharisees. What did Jesus say? Neither do I condemn you. Where are your accusers, woman? They're gone. You know why they're gone? Because God got rid of them. The voice of God will always get rid of the accusation. The voice of God will never come with the accusation. It will remove the accusation. And then it will say, the accusers are gone, and guess what? Their voice never came from me, because neither do I condemn you. You see? And so when we recognize that's the voice of the Father, man, we begin lining up with that voice. Right? And that's the best thing that can happen. Glory to God. Did you turn it on?
Yeah, I was just going to say it's funny that we just ended up with that. Because I think the church sees God as, they see Christ as he came to fix. They don't see that he came to sit with them and show them who they were. I think they see Christ as he came to fix. And now in their heart are like trying to fix everybody else as well. But it's beautiful when we see that he came to sit with us and not judge. And so.
Yeah, he came to reveal the beauty he sees in us, right? Jim.
I guess it's okay to. This is a perfect example of what we're talking about. I think I'll just read it. This is a person who's in a terribly abusive relationship, has been for a long time. And here's the note. A friend sent me this article to read. I read it and felt as though my life was over. To me, this all tells me that God wants me to stay no matter what. And I am now so upset, I feel like if I don't stay and endure all this for the rest of my life, that God will turn his back on me and have nothing to do with me. I wanted to end my life after reading this. Mm. And it's an article that a friend of hers sent her. And I read it, and I thought, you know, well-meaning friends can do a lot of damage when they hadn't walked in those shoes. They don't really know what this is about. But anyway, isn't it?
That's it.
Yeah.
That's just it. Well-meaning. We all want to come with an answer, right? We see something that we perceive to be not from God or that doesn't bring life, and we all want to come with an answer. Many times the answers we come with, man, they didn't come from God, right? And so let us just sit for a little while. It doesn't mean an answer can't come through us that is from God, okay? But let us not think that the answer is us. Let us know the answer is God and sit from that foundation. And
I didn't tell this person that they should stay or leave. That's not my responsibility.
Amen. And that leads into this example that I'm going to give. And we have to preface it by, this isn't to say to stay or to leave. Okay, but a guy that the Bible, and we'll end with this, and this is a compelling story about dealing with somebody in darkness, because this guy was in darkness. But the Bible college that I went to, the guy who started the Bible college, before that he did many different things, and he was called out to a house, and he's got a teaching about this. He was called out to a house where the woman was being physically and emotionally abused, something serious. And her children were being abused seriously. The guy had the daughters locked up and chained up in the basement and wasn't feeding them and such and everything. And he was beating on the woman and everything else. And the guy was, for lack of a better term, he was into like some wicked voodoo stuff where he was sacrificing animals in the house and doing all this stuff. And the guy actually had tapped into the occult or the power of the devil. And the reason the woman got with him to begin with was because her first husband died. And she was in one of the stores they owned together, grieving the loss of her first husband. And this guy, the second husband that was into the animal sacrifice and everything, he walked in and began telling her how her husband just died and that he was God. And he was sent to her to make her life better. Well, she was in so much grief that he read her mail. He knew these things about her life, so she went along with it. Well, he put her in all this bondage, been beaten on her. The police were called out all the time. She was put in, you know, to the hospital. And she had all of her group of church friends trying to get her to leave and wanting her to leave. There's nothing wrong with leaving in that situation. So this isn't about whether they leave or don't leave, okay? Let every person be led by the heart, whether they go or not go. So don't make a law out of this. We try to make a law out of everything. Is this an example of how light overcomes darkness, okay? But they called this minister out because they wanted the minister, as a minister, to make her feel okay with leaving, right? Because she was under, like, the same kind of law. If I leave, then God will reject me. So the minister just came and said, listen, God's not commanding you to stay. You can leave if you want. And God's not judging you. He's not against you or anything like that. There's no condemnation for you to leave. You don't have to stay. And then you know what came out of her heart? What do you mean I don't have to stay? What do you mean I can leave? And the guy was like, well, I mean, all I meant was that greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. God is greater than all this that's happening to you. And so I'm just setting you free to do what's in your heart. You can leave, but greater is you, he that's in you, than he that's in the world. The woman decided to stay, having been set free to leave, and knowing that God would bless her. She stayed. And what happened was, it ended with them going to a counselor. And when they got to the Christian counselor, they let the guy talk first. And the guy essentially blamed the woman for everything he had been doing. And she sat there and didn't say one word the whole time that he was blaming her for everything. The Christian, because she didn't say one word disputing it, the Christian counselors assumed it was all true. And then immediately after that, they started laying into her. They started telling the man, you don't have to put up with that. You don't have to stay with her. You can go. You don't have to be with her. You don't have to subject yourself to that. And they just basically started chastising the woman and telling the man about how he didn't have to put up with it and he could go. Then they let the woman talk. You know what the woman said? I used to think that you were my problem. And then I realized that you weren't my problem at all. And then I realized there was something in my heart that was hurting me. And I found God in that place. Now listen, that sounds like foolishness to us. And I'm going to keep reiterating this. Don't interpret what I'm saying as me giving some type of law that says you should stay in an abusive relationship. We're not talking about whether you should stay or whether you should go. We're talking about how someone's darkness can be conquered. Okay? And the guy couldn't believe what came out of her mouth and how she didn't try to justify herself and she didn't point the finger at him. That when they left the meeting, he was beside himself. You know what he told her? Clearly, your God is greater than mine. And he got saved and filled with the Holy Spirit right there. He went and enlisted in the Bible college and became an ordained minister and began preaching the gospel like nobody's business. Now, this isn't to say that if you're in an abusive relationship, you have to stay. It's not to say you have to go. It's to say be led in your heart by the Spirit of God. Okay, but the example is, she didn't do anything to try to fix him. She didn't do anything to try to set him free. She started fellowshipping with God and committed him into God's hands. And he ended up being delivered by her not doing anything. Right? Do you guys follow that example? And I'm going to say it again because I know there's a whole lot of people that have suffered abuse. Do not misinterpret what I'm saying as to mean you should stay in an abusive relationship. Okay? Do not interpret that. But understand that I'm saying greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. And you're free to live by your heart and live by the Spirit and not by some external commandment that tells you what to do either way. Okay? Does that make any sense? Do you guys hear my heart in that? Okay, if you feel in your heart, you got to get away from that thing. Listen, man, you have God's approval. If you feel in your heart, God's going to overcome that thing, and you find this overwhelming strength, man, you can stay if you want. Right? Far be it, and this connects with what Jim said. It's not for me to tell someone what to do. It's for me to remove all the laws telling them what to do so that they can then hear clearly from God for themselves. So often we want to tell people what to do. It's not for us to tell people what to do. It's for us to remove the laws that are trying to tell them what to do, where they judge themselves by what they do or don't do, so that they can be set free to actually hear from God about what they want to do. Does that make sense? Otherwise, we're taking responsibility for, and we're not being responsible to. I hope that makes sense. If it doesn't, man, I commit that thing into the hands of God, and people can just understand what I'm saying in that thing. Anyone want to add on to that? Anyone want to rebuke me? The people online want to rebuke me. Anyone? If anybody wants to know where that story is, and because you want to hear it for yourself, and you want to rebuke the guy who told it, you probably won't get to him by now because, you know, he's, you know, got so many in-betweens. But if you just want to hear the series for yourself, I can fish it out and point you to it, and you can go listen to the account for yourself. But it's just a sign and a wonder, not testifying of what we should do, but just testifying to how the light and life of God overcomes darkness, right? Glory to God. Father, we just thank you for your word. We just thank you that, man, all the words that were spoken forth here today, that you can just grab those words, you can resonate those words in people's hearts, and you can just connect them and reveal the Spirit in all those words. That you can bring understanding to what was said, that you can bring forth life in people, that you can bring forth freedom in people, that they can be set free from every bondage and burden that's tried to come onto their life, that they can be set free in their relationship with you, that they can be set free to just enjoy your life in them, that they can be set free to just live by the desire and the passion in their heart without worried about being judged by you. Thank you, Father. Amen. Glory to God. You guys rock, man. I love you.